Hello, my friends, and welcome. Let's start from the news I partially described yesterday, the attack on the Russian ship. Yes, finally, after all, it was the Russian big landing ship Novocherkassk, the Project 775. It is not the first big Russian landing ship which Russia loses in the Black Sea. And it is pretty much what is left from the ship, just wreckage, but we understand that it is the forward deck part, the command center of the ship. This is the upper construction of antenna, and this is the aft turret. Here we go with it. I zoomed in for you to show that definitely it is the turret or what is left from it. All the day Russia said that the ship was just damaged. I guess that indeed it is damaged severely. It was just fun to watch how the experts say that they need just 6 months to repair the ship. Well, I don't really think that it looks like the ship after all. What about the crew of the ship? There should be at least 87 people, so military sailors. The actual number during this attack is unknown, and you may say that there should be around 3 people, so the ship was already docked to the port and there is no necessity in keeping people over there, but it's Russia. I'm 100% sure that they haven't rented any kind of the accommodation for their sailors, and based on many Russian military sailors' stories, I'm sure that all of the crew members were on board. Maybe just some of the senior officers were missing. If we speak about the commercial vessels regulations, even though the ships sometimes stay in a port for a long time, still you need to have enough crew members for the ship to operate in case of some emergency. For example, the fire on board, so just the limited part of the crew is allowed to land on the shore and go to do some shopping. But in the military cases, everything is much more strict. That's why I think that all of the crew members stayed on board. But the real figures will be known after some of the years. The history will show the same as for Moskva ship, because Russia still says that majority of the crew survived the Moskva ship attack. And this is the Russian so-called journalist. She is showing the debris of the big Russian landing ship that are around Feodosia City. You may see the size of those debris, they are huge. As it is said by Ukrainian command, Ukraine used Scalp or Storm Shadow cruise missiles to target the ship. But again, she says that all of the debris in Feodosia are just showing that the ship was damaged. Yes, of course, those huge debris might say that there are some minor damages of the ship. The guy just looking at this wreckage and says, oh my god, what happened there? Ukraine is coming, my friend, Ukraine. Definitely shows how significant the kaboom really was. The reason the explosion was so powerful is not because of the cruise missiles, but because of the cargo of the ship. Russia uses the big landing ships to transport some of the goods for their army, including ammunition, artillery shells, rocket munition, and even drones. For now, experts are confused about the real cargo of the ship because it's hard to find what was inside. But mostly sources say that this ship was coming from Iran, delivering drones or artillery munition. We also have the satellite images, so this is the ship, and just pay attention on this one as well. The big landing ship is gone, and this ship is also gone. Here we have more detailed photo of the second ship, and here is the picture from the close perspective of this ship. It's called UTS-150. UTS means учебно-тренировочное судно, which is the training vessel. That's it. From the name, we may understand that this ship was used to train the Russian cadets. At the same time, I don't think that Ukraine targeted this ship on purpose. It just got the critical damages from the explosion of the big Russian landing ship. The fire in the port was all the night, and just during the morning time, Russia managed to deal with it. Here we have the major losses of the Russian big military ships of their Black Sea Marine fleet. From this report, we might see that Novocherkassk was damaged even before in March of 2022, but later on was repaired and finally kaputted yesterday evening. Plus, two of the ships of the same class were significantly damaged. It means that Russia has no more abilities to perform the big landing operations without those ships. Ukraine has cancelled that ability for the Russian Navy without even having the military ships. Well, we have some of the small boats plus the drone boats, which I believe also will be used in the nearby future. But in general, Ukraine fights with no navy against the Russian Black Sea Marine Fleet and already caused 20% of the losses to it. It is definitely one of the biggest achievements for Ukrainian army. And again, it shows that the modern day war is a little different to what was happening before in the 20th century. Now let's go briefly for the front lines review. We have some of the success for Ukrainian army as well. So today Russia again tried to attack Sinkivka village. Our guys, I think, got tired about it and started the counterattack towards the Russian positions in this local forest. The counteroffensive was successful and the Ukraine took some part of the ground. Let me show you the other source with this information. I rely on Mykiosk 73 because his updates are more or less precise. He analyzes many of the sources, including the images from the drones, and later on published the information about the gains or losses. So today Russia launched their tanks with infantry. Infantry again went to the village, and with the Ukrainian counterattack, our guys were able to get some ground under control. So sorry, it was my mistake, I put it like this, but actually we took the small part, but nevertheless it's the success for Ukrainian army. Russia tries many of the attacks again and again towards Sinkivka, all of them just fail. Let me show you some of the video. This is the Russian T-90M ProRiv tank, as Putin says, their best tank of the Russian army. It goes somewhere but was targeted by Ukrainian drone. The drone went just in the forward part of the tank between the turret and the tank base. It is the most vulnerable frontal part of the tank. After it, they start to turn the turret into some directions and later on just stop the tank and start to leave it. So crew members survived, driver evacuated and stopped near to the tank. I think he was wounded. And two of the other crew members left the tank and run away from the place to their positions. It really shows us the tremendous effectiveness of the FPV drones. It costs around $500, but it may bring devastation to the multi-million dollar or multi-million ruble Russian tank. And we have one more success of Ukrainian army not far away from Terni. Remember how Russia assaulted toward this place? They are not that far away from this village, but today Ukraine concentrated the forces and started the counterattack towards the Russian positions, successfully taking the ground. So here is the Ukrainian counterattack. Obviously Russia is not happy about it, that is why they start to shell this place, and also they have couple of their own vectors, but Ukraine uses lots of the surveillance, huge surveillance in this place, probably in attempt to get the information about the Russian positions to move further. With this picture from many of the directions, I cannot state that Russia got the initiative already on the front line. No, they are unable to regroup their forces for the major assaults and sometimes they lose the ground. At the same time, they have more of everything, that is why today they reached the outskirts of Marinka, taking full Marinka under control. We have the confirmation about it from the Deep State military map, not only from this source, but also from Valery Zaluzhny, who gave today the press conference. He admitted that Ukrainian army lost control over Marinka, but he also said it's better not to put it as the anti-PR or PR action. He confirmed that the Ukrainian army is concentrated on defending all of the settlements, all of the cities and villages, but not for every cost. Still, the lives of Ukrainian soldiers is more important than keeping control over some villages. So he proposed to look at the picture in general, and in general there is no huge move from the Russian side. Unfortunately, Zaluzhny said that Russia might capture Avdiivka in around 2 or 3 months. I also think like that, unfortunately. Why? Because Ukraine wasn't able to build a significant defense in this place. Why it wasn't done, that's the other question. I'm actually out of clue who is responsible for the engineering forces of Ukraine, maybe also Zaluzhny himself, because after all he's the general commander of the Ukrainian army. But I also understand, judging from the information which is coming to the press, that it is not so easy for Zaluzhny to control everything. There's some division in the Ukrainian army. Some generals obey to Zelensky directly and some obey to Zaluzhny. Well, it's hard to explain everything in one video, but definitely there is some division which is, I think, very bad. Here we go with the video from Avdiivka. Russian Terminator was targeted by the FPV drone. In this case, Ukraine had to use many of the FPV drones to target the Terminator. Later on, the T-80 tank was also targeted. The Russian vehicles had to retreat under the bridge to save them, but it didn't help. And let me show you the area. So the bridge is located just over here. So we may not say that Russia is controlling all of this territory, and Russians are just unable to keep their positions in this industrial part. This photo was taken from one of the Ukrainian tanks. This 125mm shell was produced in Pakistan. Pakistan is supplying Ukraine with munition for more than 1 year, and according to some of the sources, Pakistan sent thousands of the shells to Ukraine, almost equal to the help from the European Union, from which we got 300,000 shells this year. But what Russia has are thousands of the scopes made in the United States of America. Yes, for the last year, Russia obtained thousands of those tools from the United States, and they even show them in their YouTube videos. How is that possible? Well, I wrote about it on my Telegram channel with more detailed explanation. In a couple of words, there are some hunting shops in Russia which buy those tools from the third countries like Kazakhstan, China or Turkey. And later on, the Russian army just takes those scopes to their units and that's it. You shouldn't be an experienced FBI agent to understand this scheme, because it's very simple and we have even names of the shops, but somehow this route still works for Russia to obtain some of the equipment even from the United States. Well, hopefully with the help of journalists and bloggers, this information will go to the proper officials in the United States and the scheme finally would be stopped. I think that it also tells a lot about corruption, not just in Ukraine. Alright, let's go back to Valery Zaluzhny for a moment, because he was on press conference. It happens not very often with him. So there he spoke about the general idea of Ukraine to mobilize more soldiers into Ukrainian army, and definitely our members of parliament will review the new law for that, because the current mobilization is not always going according to the current law in Ukraine. The new mobilization procedures are very strict, I would say even more strict than in the Russian Federation, according to which the rights of the men between 18 and 60 will be cut almost completely if they wouldn't like to join the Ukrainian army. The penalties are huge fines or sometimes even jail, depends on the circumstances. Plus the removal from the social life, so inability to have the bank account, inability to obtain the job, healthcare, all of that is eliminated for the individuals who wouldn't like to join the Ukrainian army if they are asked for it. Yes, it is more strict than in the Russian Federation, so Zaluzhny made some of the comments, and still it is project. Probably in the next months it will be corrected, because according to it, even disabled people should join the Ukrainian army, and women too, even with children. So I personally think that it is not acceptable for disabled people and women. They should raise their children after all. Well, in general, those strict measures are understandable because Ukraine needs more army men and it is in war with Russia, with a huge enemy. But in those new regulations, I think we are in lack of the positive things like reforms in Ukrainian army, or the flexible contracts for the Ukrainian soldiers, or the flexible contracts for Ukrainian soldiers. Because for now, if you sign the contract with the Ukrainian army, you go there and that's it. You don't have vacations, you don't have the free time to spend with your family, you don't see them. And it just continues and continues with no light at the end. That's why I personally know a couple of people who fight on the front lines, but they are volunteers. They do not serve in the Ukrainian army. They haven't signed any kind of the contracts and just go there to fight. They do it, for example, for 1 month and then they go home for 1 week to relieve this stress. And after that, they go to fight again and this sequence continues. The downside is that they don't have any salary, any kind of the social benefits as Ukrainian soldiers do have. And still they need to obey to some of the orders from the Ukrainian army command, because they are volunteers. So the main reason for them to be volunteers is to fight for their country with a flexible schedule. I'm sure that if Ukraine hires soldiers with those flexible schedules, there would be many more volunteers who would like to mobilize into Ukrainian army with salary with benefits and fight, for example, 45 days with 10 days off, something like that. Even the Russian army has the similar staff for their volunteers. They're promised 6 months contract. If they're alive, they are free to go elsewhere. And after all, they know that they have the chance to return back to their families. It is very important, but in Ukrainian army, we don't see it. This factor, unfortunately, stops many of people to join Ukrainian army. Valery Zaluzhny also admitted his own mistake. His plan was to cause Russians severe losses, for example, in Bakhmut. But Russians do not stop. They do not look at their losses. Zaluzhny said that any other army would stop at this point. According to the calculations, Russia lost around 250 up to 300,000 soldiers in this war. We're speaking about totally KA. Imagine, for example, the aggressive war performed by the United States of America. It's not the defense war, it's an aggressive one, during which just in 2 years, United States Army would lose 300,000 soldiers. For example, the Vietnam War was 20 years long, from 1955 till 1975, and the United States Army lost around 58,000 soldiers during all of those years. And even then, there were tons of the protests in the United States. How could we fight so well, losing our lives? So Zaluzhny was thinking from his own perspective, from the perspective of Ukraine or any kind of the civilized country, but Russia is something different. Their society simply doesn't care about their losses right now. There is almost no voice from the relatives who lost their loved ones. Nothing. Actually, I'm quite shocked about it, how the Russian society developed. I remember the time then the Russian submarine Kursk got destroyed. It was lying on the seafloor. Huge tragedy for the Russian people. Everyone was speaking about it, in Russia and outside, blaming Putin as well. But it was the period then Putin just got his power. And now, for example, Moskva ship with many more people on board, no one says anything. The kaboom of the Russian big landing ship with all crew on board, I believe it was like that, but they say that there were just 3 of the sailors, which is complete bullshit. The same goes for the war in Chechnya. Russians were very concerned at that time. Actually, under the society pressure, Yeltsin, the previous Russian president, signed a deal with Chechen leaders and recognized the sovereign right of Ichkeria, so the Chechen Republic. But in Ukraine, Russia loses more soldiers per week than for 2 wars in Chechnya. Yes, it happens sometimes when they try to get Avdiivka, for example, or in Bakhmut. The scale of the war in Ukraine is definitely outstanding. It has never been like that since the Second World War. Nevertheless, majority of the Russian population still supports Putin. It's crazy. What is the potential of the Russian mobilization? They might mobilize around 25 million men into their army. Judging on their losses for 2 of the years, they've just lost 1% of their full mobilization resource. So if people in Russia are okay with this, why should Putin stop? For him personally, it doesn't matter. Those are just the figures on the paper. He doesn't have mercy or conscience. He's a cold-headed KGB dick who has just goal and ambitions. How would he reach his aim? He doesn't really care. Unprincipled, cold-headed butcher for Ukrainian people and for the Russians too. Alright, great news for Ukrainian pilot training. The first group of the future F-16 pilots has already finished the training in the United Kingdom. It's the first stage of the training. I believe they also had some of the practice, and later on they're going to other country, to Denmark, for continuation of their training. There are lots of the Ukrainian pilots now on the training, and they go through the several stages. Some of them at the very beginning learning English. Others go through the theoretical course and simulator training, finally the practice. I think it happens in Denmark, as well as in many other countries of coalition. Well, hopefully we can obtain F-16s very soon. This winter, that's my forecast. My friends, please don't forget to press the like button to this video. By doing so, you help me a lot. Also, if you want to support my job, there will be some of the links in a video description just below. Thank you so much for your kind support. I wish you all a peaceful sky wherever you are, and have a great time.